I made it this far. And in the process, I think 22 years passed. So the person is not the same. And therefore, what I need is to give you the message. And probably this will be the last conference where I really want to focus. That I appreciate so much of research has been done. And all these conferences, I really learned a great deal from different scholars in different fields. And that was also a kind of inspiration. I grew up as an agnostic. My mother was a Sanatani. My two brothers couldn't care less. My father was agnostic. Because we both were stuck on the point, if there is a God who made us, then who made God? And that was a door we could not unlock in a mathematical or logical way, so we got stuck forever. Finally, the light came when I read Satyarath Prakash by Swami Dayanand Saraswati ji of that time, and there was just one mention, and suddenly, you know, everything flashed that the divine creator is not a mortal, and no mortal can create an immortal world. So this God business, we really do not have to talk about it, because our original sources do not mention this necessity of worshipping or thinking of somebody as the person who created. So my first request is, I'm a non-technical person, so for me, doing two things at a time is a little bit challenging, and especially when the microphone is temperamental. Okay, so I'm going to give the summary position of Dharma, which I think is the lowest common denominator for all the different kind of variations, and variations in traditions, and focus on different aspects of Vedic Dharma. So that is why I request that everybody, before giving a vote on the lowest common denominator, should not leave this room and miss the dinner. The point is that with all this research, I am myself saturated with so much of dense material, and I'm exhausted also. So what is the ground impact in the transfer of that knowledge to our children? There are three common questions a seven-year-old person is accosted with on the streets of New York or someplace. They say, "Who is your God?" And the kid says, "Ram, Krishan, who?" And by the time they say, "Jesus." Okay? You don't have whole life to answer this question. They give you just about a few seconds. Okay, then they say, "Which is your holy book?" Again, Bhagavad Gita, Ramayan, what? And they say, "Here is the Bible." Then they say, "Which is your basic belief?" Again, blank. We have so many basic beliefs, but which one is the basic belief? So the answer is, Jesus is the Savior. Here goes all the later learning. At the age of 10, you say that my kid should not go to prom, and this is not culture, this is not compatible with Dharma. It's all useless. You lost it, and you lost it big time. So what I am thinking now, at this almost last phase of my life, I should make it a point. I created a book as a form of lesson modules. It is ready-made lessons. You start with the age of 4, go to up to 8, takes 4 years to learn that much material. Give them the experience, because their cognitive level is very low. So you are not talking about community. You are talking about neighborhood, your friends. You see, things with which they are familiar. So you don't talk about the whole world, Vasudev Kutumbakam. You talk about this your little place. And that should be happy. Nobody, and make them understand that nobody wants tragedy. So peace of mind is the thing. So what are the end goals that as practicing Hindus we are going to enforce or not enforce? That is not Hindu Dharma itself. Just inculcate so that they can appreciate what are the three things that they need to have in their mind for success in life, for peace of mind, for bliss, satisfaction, stress-free, that kind of thing. So I created, where am I? Summary position. So let's this way. See, it is so difficult to do this. Okay. Now, as I said, I really appreciate, isko haath mein le le? May I? Act to nahi karega? Okay.
Can step back and then you can see the slide.
Okay. So I appreciate all the research done in reviving tradition, in bringing up, deepening, you see, layer by layer, unfolding various depths of our Indian Vedic knowledge. And I gained a lot. Now we are all here to find how, in simple words, to our children at their level. Now you pretend that you are at the age of dealing with 4 years old and you show the same amazement that they are going to show. So, and I am going to seek your help and solution. I have my position. I want, if you don't agree with me or you want to add something, please do that now. Because once we decide it, what is the lowest common denominator that is common to all of us, and we insist that these are our priorities, in that case, then there is we don't talk about something odd in the public discourse or seem stupid in interfaith councils or whatever they are. So, and in the classrooms, you see. And please do not use internet sources, because they come from different perspectives. They are written as blogs or something by people who do not have that experience of a tropical country. We are a tropical country and we were least affected by Holocene period. So we go back into beginning of civilization after the Holocene period, long, long way back. Our experiences are different. What rivers mean to us is not the same thing what rivers mean to in Europe. What is relevant in how nature is so vibrant and dancing in tropical country, it is not the same thing in tundra or Europe or North America. So they are basically hunter-gatherers and they still continue to follow those habits even though they have agricultural abundance. So things are relative, relevant to certain places. So you cannot duplicate that experience, but people who are growing here, so what exactly I want, and probably you want too, that people should be changing their next generation as convinced Hindus. Hindus knowing concepts and depth and common sense. You see, most of the things are that I talk is common sense. And I tell them there is sense, there is common sense, and then there is nonsense. That there was X time in the desert of some place, about 2,000 years back, when the earth was flat and the blood was a stagnant pool, and there were no resources in those places. Those things are not relevant today. We cannot duplicate that environment or those time frames. And we that is mythical, irrelevant, and I would say common sense and nonsense. So, on the other hand, our devas, we allow them to call mythical gods, and we call it mythology. Our own people, when they are introducing to a dance sequence of Bharatanatyam, they say, this is mythical god, Krishna. In this age, when the dating is done, and it's part of history, and the whole documents are cultural documents, which has laid down the basis of our value system and cultural ethos, we are calling it mythology and we are letting it, we are accepting it. So what kind of apathetic attitude and lack of, in other words, inertia is that we are not able to move forward and cross those words out which are not applicable, which have no Sanskrit equivalents. So we'll come back to this. This is a brainstorming session. So we will not, we'll find out the common denominator. Okay. So I'm going to say my position. But before that, here is something in the morning. Somebody talked about we cannot get rid of caste system. And we Hindus created. That is another mythical thing. So I'm giving you just reading the quote. I did not compile it in that. And I'm reading it. King Bimbisar wanted to know the identity of a wandering monk passing through Rajgraha. Who was that wandering monk? Gautam Buddha. The wandering monk, Lord Buddha, replied that his given name is Siddharth. He was asked, who are you? You look like royalty, but you are dressed as a beggar. He says, my given name is Siddharth, Shakya born, Jati is Shakya, Gotra is Gautam, but at this time, he didn't belong to anything or anyone, which means I have no Varna. I have no occupation. So, what is it telling us? That the king didn't ask, what is your caste? And he didn't say, what is my caste? You see, identity. Identity and the jati, surname is very important and we should not get rid of it. Because in Hindu dharma and all of the Ayurvedic sciences, they say that seventh cousin also is considered incest and not a viable kind of marriage. So of course, I mean, people marry next cousin or something like that. But that is why, because you have preserved the jati. Kapoor cannot marry a Kapoor, and Kapoor cannot marry my mother's maiden name as well, because this is matrilineal kind of thing. In any case, so we build relevance. So how do I go ahead with the content? First we determine what is the content that we are picking up. A, B, C, D, E, cross whichever you don't want and whichever is common, go ahead. Then we bring the scientific, we weave in objectives. What exactly I want from my students or from my children. Unless you have goals and objectives, even if they are not fulfilled in their entirety, but that is where you are aiming at. There has to be a thrust. Okay, how to build relevance of key concepts and traditions to modern day life. It is so relevant, so very relevant, that everybody is copying it, appropriating it under different names. And we are silent spectators, not objecting, not claiming our own heritage, not claiming our right to our own narrative. So this is where you have to have courage. And if we all are saying here we are proud Hindus, then please go and say it among 10 Americans, I am a proud Hindu. See how it goes. Would you be able to do it? If not, then how do you expect your children will face this kind of identity? So these are some of the key issues. For me, they are extremely important because I see two generations have already gone missing the point. Okay. So hands-on projects. So we have hands-on project which kids do and get an experience. Enabling students to make choices. Create solution-oriented projects. And bring some kind of sustainability of the earth, weave in. After all, we are worshipping, we are offering devotion and reverence to nature. All of these, Indra and Agni, and everything, they are Deva. So those specific energy, we are then creating their relevance in times, bring in environmentalism, conservation of resources, stopping the pollution, and you know, whole lot of these building blocks come out of that. Okay. By the way, on that caste business, there is something that I came across. This was written by an ICS officer in 1920. And this is a British officer. He was census officer. And he wrote, and this is, I think everybody should have it tattooed on the arm so that anybody who questions you believe in caste system, you show like this. Because you forget. We all forget. It says, we pigeonholed everyone by caste. We, British. And if we could not find a true cause for them, label them with the name of hereditary occupation. We deplore the caste system and its effects on social and economic problems. But we are largely responsible for the system we deplore. Now from now onwards, nobody should do the breastfeeding that Hindus created the caste. The untouchability started from 1000 AD onwards, when the Muslims came and their women could not come out. So somebody had to go inside, and usually they were castrated children who did that. And that is how untouchability started. So this was a like digression, but I said that I would address this point. So let us forget about, and caste and social structures in other dharma traditions we don't discuss. So why is it that we are so much bothered about it? Okay. Now, we have freedom to think and freedom to be. So children have a choice. You take them out and you make them familiar with their surroundings. Let them make their choice, which they think is really a giver or gives you something. That is the concept of introducing them, devas, right? Somebody who gives you something, whether it gives you light or whether it is a shining object or a son or mother or father, do this experiment. It will be how the young kids respond. In fact, Dr. Balram Singh invited me last December. And extempore, instead of the teachers showing who were going to see the presentation, the students came. Now these are assorted age groups starting from 8 to about 11 years old. 35 of them trying to elbow each other and sitting. And I am asking myself that I am speaking to them or their teachers. Balram Singh ji said that right now you do teaching. And I did start. So it was supposed to be 20 minutes. After 40 minutes, kids didn't want to go. Their parents were upset that they have some kind of next appointment. What I'm saying giving them experience is involving them so that they are literally focused, amazed, what an awe-inspiring world. And that is where the reverence comes. You see, the devotional aspect. We don't want to disturb it. Okay. So, we don't have the freedom at this time. Inimical role of institutions, including the worst enemy was independent governments in India. Because every time I had a fight with any board of education, they said, first go and ask your government of India to change their website. When they do it, we will do it. Now tell me how logical it is for them to say, and how illogical for the government India not to do it in so many decades. Today, what is called the Indian Historical Research Center, something like that, they are in the fourth year of the BJP government, they are still kicking their heels, figuring out to make a new textbook. That is the state of affairs stuff. So social expectations of the majority. So living in a culture where we are not a majority, it is intimidating by itself, right? So when we are among 10 Americans, we kind of have a slight tendency to have hang down look, which is like on the defensive. So pressure on youngsters to be like everybody. Now the question, who is everybody? Who is everybody? Everybody is not the same. So appreciation of diversity is right now inculcated. You are not the same. Okay. Self-alienation and mental health. Both of these things, you see, they are called confused desis now. Why are they confused? Whose fault is this? Because ours. We as parents failed them. Because of our own ignorance or lack of understanding of our own original sources. Okay, selecting the significant parts of Dharma. So there are three parts that we are thinking of. First thing is to pick up the content we all agree on, basically basic things. Then we pick up the objectives, that this is whether they are to be convinced Hindus or parents want them to be practicing Hindus. In that case, we go to Karam Kand and Sanskars and festivals and fasts and the whole nine yards. And then we make cohesive, logical lessons, right? And the lessons should be age appropriate. Modules. Kids' attention span is less than 10 minutes. Don't tell me 5 minutes left because I'm just started. Yeah, but if I don't state the position, what will they do? Others will have next conference. Okay, so who will teach? Teaching technique, learner-oriented lessons, audience to make suggestions for, you make the suggestions now, add-ons. Transfer of knowledge, difficult task ahead, because A, the priests are nearly illiterate, they only this thing, and there's a mistranslation. For example, in the morning, without offending or ruffling anybody's feathers, Hinduism word itself is a misnomer. Ism, look at the dictionary meaning. Ism is canonical or dogmatic. We are anything but. Two Hindus are walking, and they are walking on three different paths. You see, that is how free we are. And so we are not ism. That word should be avoided. I would say let us drill it in our mind so that by accident we don't say Hinduism, Hindu Dharma. And in Hindi we say Dharma, Sikh Dharma, Jain Dharma, Bodh Dharma. What is the problem with this God business and with the ism? Why we are the isms and nobody else is? Okay. So how to bridge the divide between, now this is Puranic traditions of storytellings and gathas and learning the values. Then there is the Vedic vision of Sanatan Dharma. So you have to between those two. Puranic traditions come where you are talking about history, Mahabharata, Ramayana and other stories, prehistoric times, and cultural documents and Karmakand. And vision of Sanatana Dharma is building the concepts in the Vedas and in the Bhagavad Gita and Upanishad. So there are many stumbling blocks, whom to follow, who is your authentic source, tradition, where do pundits fit in? This is another question. Is an atheist a Hindu? Hindu is everybody who believes in Dharma. Dharyeti iti Dharma. Sustainability of all life, respect for sanctity of all life, whoever believes in is Hindu. So Hindu is not just a geographic term, it's also any human being who is like that. Now when you have Anantam, universe is Anantam, and Brahma and infinite, divine is infinite and Anantam, in Anantam all the sets, even the zero set fits in, because it is Anantam. So atheists are Hindus. Who is God, belief in God, existence, one. So, clear objectives, enabling children, learning basic concepts, and exam caste system idea. Okay, clarifying misperception and correcting fallacious notions, no founder superstition, and the words to avoid, mythology. Hindu gods, Hindu goddesses, as if we were as a species made by somebody else. And every species has their own god. You see, what nonsense is that? The priest is saying Mahadeva Namami, and the English translator is we are praying to Hindu gods and goddesses. So these words do not relate. Forcible translation can make a mess. So in one of the plays which was translated from Sanskrit, Parvati was described as a tribal. In the next sentence, she became a Dalit. Okay, coming out of the box of religion. So everything changes with time. Evolution, oscillating universe, time is everything. All these modern concepts in that. You see, evolution, Das Avatar, or evolution of the jiva within us before it is born. This is all evolution, recycling. The plant never dies. Matter is indestructible. What happens to it? Take the children out. They will point out, it didn't disappear. See, matter did not disappear, it transformed. It will come back in different way. So, these are later on, these simple concepts which you learn in the backyard of your own house and teach your children, eventually these are building blocks for other scientific aspects, like the universe is oscillating. We are in a twirl of dynamic world of twirl of time, place, and there is nothing absolute. Huh? You? Okay. So, be friends with nature. This is the lesson for small children. And learning to live on the earth. This is built in that. Respect. Okay. Sanctity of life. God business, reality of the divine. And his hold over us, the fear and revenge, we have to get rid of that nonsense. Divine is, even Shri Krishna could not change the cycle of reality. Okay. Brahma and Deva. If Brahma is the divine, then Deva cannot be infinite as well. It's only the rest are finite. Okay. Cosmic reality, scientific aspects, karmakand. Okay. Role of devotion and practices. Christian idea of God and humans are not going to use the word rituals, because the root word of that is rite. And we are not going to use the word mythology, as I said. And there are so many other words. Devas and Devis is fine. If the English dictionary can absorb and has not fallen apart by including Ghotala, Jugaad, Swami, Pandit, Guru, it won't fall apart if we include Devas and Devis and Brahma. Okay? And symbolism is a separate dharana. And then for the college level students, they have to have knowledge of physics, psychology and philosophy. Without these basic knowledge, Bhagavad Gita cannot be understood in real good depth. It is if Shri Krishna was whoever he was the first psychologist of the world and one of the only philosopher that was produced at that time. Given of the situation. Absolute. These are college level courses. And I gave the outline, because we are always in time crunch. So, this is the book I wrote. These are lesson format from 4 to 8, 8 to 14 and 12 and 14, and then college, high school, then college level. And I use these lessons in temple schools, in different colleges, in presentations, and different levels. And 16 years I taught all these, and I reproduced this at the request of my grandchildren. They said, Nani, now that you are ready to make it for other children, other parents. So I decided, why not? So now you take it up from here, whatever you want to add, or I hope I woke you up and removed some of your exhaustion by something lively.